Good Sunday to you. This week starts with an impeachment investigation into the sitting president of the United States, and our sources say White House Chief of Staff Mick Mulvaney is in trouble with the boss. We're told that the president blames Mulvaney for the swift backlash from the whistleblower's report. The White House denies Mulvaney is in any trouble.
We've also learned Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell actually encouraged the White House to release the rough transcript of the president's call with Ukrainian leader. Why? Well, he thought it would exonerate the president.
Plus, what will we learn from Kurt Volker when he appears before three House committees this week? The former U.S. Special Envoy to Ukraine stepped down from his post on Friday.
There's a lot to talk about here, and our coverage of the impeachment inquiry kicks off with Kristen Holmes. She's in Washington right now. Kristen, what are sources there saying that is their frustration in the White House, that there was no plan, as we understand it, to deal with the transcript once it was released, and that is why President Trump and part of the administration is so frustrated?
Good morning, Christy and Victor. Well, that's absolutely right. We have to keep this in mind. There are a lot of White House aides who did not want this transcript to be released. Many argued against it. Now, the big idea here is not that President Trump is upset that it was released, but it's that there was a lack of response to this backlash. Keep this in mind. Last weekend, we were talking about how the White House was mulling over whether or not to release this transcript. That means they had days to prepare some sort of strategy, some sort of response once they did, in fact, release the transcript. And of course, we didn't see that from the White House. It was actually very quiet. They stood by the transcript, but really no explanation of what exactly was going on there. So this has caused a lot of tension within the White House, not just about this, but moving forward. What is this going to look like around an impeachment inquiry? We did see a little bit of how that strategy might play out from the White House. Take a look at this. This is President Trump's tweets yesterday. There are dozens of tweets here. You can see he went through everything. He slammed Democrats. He released a video at one point saying that he was the victim of a scam. We know that saying that he is a victim is a big part of his strategy. This is his direct appeal. You see that big one there, presidential harassment. He's going off on Twitter, doing his appeal to his followers, to his base. But is this going to work or not? And I want to kind of go back in time here and talk about the Clinton administration, and when he was going through the impeachment process, they had an entire war room set up. This was to deal with just this process, to deal with the media surrounding this process. President Trump's team does not have that. And I want to point to a statement that was given to us by Trump's private counsel. It says that there is no war room that's going to be set up. He says, I am confident that our existing legal team will be in a position to respond appropriately to any developments. But again, a lot of tension in the White House. Do they need to set something up? Is this Trump appealing directly through Twitter, through these statements, painting himself a victim? Is that going to work in something of this magnitude?
All righty, Kristen Holmes, I know a lot to cover. Thank you.
All right, so let's take a minute here to fact check some of the president's claims on Twitter. Kristen just showed some of them. Yesterday, the president tweeted this. How do you impeach a president who has created the greatest economy in the history of our country, entirely rebuilt our military into the most powerful it has ever been, cut record taxes and regulations, fixed the VA and gotten choice for our vets after 45 years, and so much more? Well, that's a lot. Glenn Kessler, the Washington Post fact checker, sums it up best. He says this, not greatest economy, didn't rebuild military, not biggest tax cut, not record deregulation, did not create VA choice, bottomless Pinocchios galore. Now, in case you're not familiar with the Washington Post fact-checking gauge, they use Pinocchios to rate the false statements.
Yeah, the president also attacked House Intelligence Chairman Adam Schiff with this tweet. The only people that don't like my conversation with the new Ukrainian president are those that heard Representative Adam Schiff read a made-up and totally fraudulent statement to the House and public. So we want to get the record straight here as well. Schiff did not read the transcript word for word. Rather, he began the hearing by reading what he called a parody of the president's phone call. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi doubling down now on the impeachment probe against the president. Speaking at the Texas Tribune Festival last night, she said Democrats will go ahead with it regardless of any political consequences.
Look, I said to the president, and I'm saying to you,
yeah,
you've come into my wheelhouse now. To tell you the truth, I've been very prayerful about this. I'm heartbroken about it. I would just have hoped that there would be something exculpatory, something that would say, oh, this is not what it seems to be. But that's not where we are right now.
And Speaker Pelosi also said she has a responsibility to protect the Constitution, which is a system of checks and balances.
All right, so much to talk about this morning. Let's go now to Daniel Strauss, a politics reporter for Politico. Daniel, good morning.
Good morning.
So let's start here. The president, as it's reported, is upset with Mick Mulvaney, his acting chief of staff. Jay Sekulow, the president's personal attorney, says that they are not establishing a war room to handle the legal elements or the messaging. If they're upset with how the first week went, they're disappointed, what are they doing for week two, week three, as this goes on to change that?
I mean, we really don't know what's going to happen in week two, week three, but it is unusual for the president to be upset with Mick Mulvaney. Of all the chiefs of staff he's had, this is a chief of staff who has been in the president's good graces the longest, has consistently pleased him. So it is unusual here that White House officials and people close to the president and the president himself are dissatisfied with something that this chief of staff is doing right now.
Yeah, he's had three jobs in this administration, over at Consumer Protections and Office of Management and Budget, and now acting White House chief of staff. You know, there's the question of, in addition to the conversation with the president of Ukraine, there's the reporting over the weekend that they're also in this classified server, records of conversations with Mohammed bin Salman of Saudi Arabia, also President Putin of Russia. Is there any concern in the White House, the appetite in Washington to declassify those conversations as well?
I mean, there's strong appetite in Washington to declassify as many of these conversations as arise. I've been surprised by the willingness of the White House to come forward and declassify as quickly as they have these conversations, but I don't really know at this point how eager they're going to be going forward. But what they have done in acknowledging them and declassifying what has come out so far is they've shown that they are taking this inquiry very, very seriously.
Yeah, we'll see in a couple of days. The deadline is Friday for that subpoena for the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, to hand over documents to those three House committees. Let me turn now to former now U.S. envoy to Ukraine, Kurt Volker, who will be deposed by several House committees this week. In addition to Rudy Giuliani's text messages that he showed on that iPad on Fox News, there's this from the whistleblower's claim. Let's put it up. The claim that Ambassador Kurt Volker and Ambassador Gordon Sondland, ambassador to the EU for the U.S., reportedly provided advice to the Ukrainian leadership about how to, quote, navigate the demands that the president had made of Mr. Zelensky, the president of Ukraine. Detail just how critical this deposition on Thursday could be.
I mean, highly critical. This is going to be someone who was close and at hand through the most sensitive parts of these discussions between President Trump and the president of Ukraine. And it's something that is going to play a major role in this inquiry. The fact that he resigned and he's also willing to come forward and participate in this deposition means that this will be a high-profile event.
All right. Daniel Strauss with Politico. Thank you so much.
Thanks.